And behold, I am with you all days, even unto the consummation of the world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The Easter Gospels are nothing if not confusing, at least at first glance. That is to say that every evangelist tells the story as he remembers it. And we moderns going to sacred scripture expecting some sort of a strict historical or biographical accuracy, as it were, are left a little bit confused, but there's a reason for that. The Gospels were not written to teach the faith to those who read them. You learn your faith through the church. It's the church that gives you and guarantees the veracity of the Gospels, and not the other way around. That's one of the great mistakes made by the poor Protestants. So, the early church heard from apostles. To be an apostle, you had to be an eyewitness of the risen Christ. That's why St. Paul had that magnificent experience on the way to Damascus, and then was instructed himself in Arabia by our blessed Savior to catch him up with the 12. So you get, as it were, just certain recollections, reminiscences, certain points that each evangelist was inspired to make, and that's enough. To learn that already, to understand that about sacred scripture and its relationship to the church gives us the Bible, and the Bible doesn't give us the church. Not at all. What a huge difference that makes in our mentality and in our understanding. What else does the church give us today? Well, by means of tradition, which includes the sacred liturgy, the church is always teaching us. For example, we go in spirit today to the Church of Our Lady, the Queen of Martyrs. The church, a mother herself, remembers the Blessed Mother today. 1 week ago, she was singing her Vespers, her Magnificat, holding the dead Christ in her lap, the Pietà, the great sorrow of Our Lady's life, that mystical death that she endured also for our redemption. So the church goes in spirit to honor her at the ancient temple of the Pantheon, it was called, which was meant to honor all of the gods, all of the pagan gods. There's a universality that the church wants to underline in that. In the Gospel today, our Lord appears in majestic splendor. So much so that St. Matthew notes that some people doubted. They recognized him as our Lord, but they didn't recognize him, because now they saw him in his risen glory. And our Lord says with great solemn power, he uses the word all again and again. Going ye therefore, teach ye all nations. Teach them to observe all things whatsoever I have taught you. And you could see almost in the apostles both a sense of fear and of awe and of very great love and of the light starting to come on, even though they had to wait for the Holy Ghost for the light to flood their own rooms and for them to be able themselves to go out as eyewitnesses of the risen Christ and preach the truth. The church teaches us today to remember and to honor our Blessed Mother always, and to honor her as much in her sorrows as in her joys, and to honor her divine maternity, that she is indeed the Queen of all saints and the Queen of sorrows. And then next, in the epistle, it's a mystical, sort of, a mysterious text from St. Peter. St. Peter is talking about the souls who, contrary to all expectations, were saved, but so as by water. That is to say, they were some souls who did not believe Noah and mocked him. But as they were dying in the flood, they did make an act of faith. And any act of faith in the Old Testament points to Christ. And so then they ended up with the eight who were saved, that is to say, Noah and his family, they ended up in limbo. And that's what our Lord did on Good Friday evening when he descended into hell. He went to limbo and he evangelized, he preached to these souls in limbo who were contrary to all expectations, such as the mercy of God. You never anticipate it. You must not presume upon it, but you never anticipate it. They were saved. Now they had to be instructed. And our blessed Savior himself, imagine, is their preacher and their catechism teacher. How beautiful that is. And then, last of all, the apparition of our Lord. They say this gospel, which ends St. Matthew's gospel, could have been the apparition of Christ to the 500. In any case, this is the only time that our Lord made an appointment, and he kept it. Every other time our Lord appeared, he appeared suddenly, out of the blue, least expected. But this time, our Lord had sent the message twice to the ladies, I'll meet you in Galilee. And then they had a further revelation as to what time it would be. So they were there waiting for him, perhaps 500 in number, and our Lord appears. And some, as I say, doubted almost because they didn't recognize him. And then our Lord pulls himself up, as it were, to his full majesty. These are his last words on earth. This is the end of St. Matthew's gospel. Go ye therefore, teach ye all nations. And this is the first time the apostles hear the name of the Blessed Trinity, in which they must baptize souls, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, the first of the seven sacraments, the gateway to all the rest, as it is the gateway for us to heaven. So you see, there's a lot in today's Mass. There's a lot of instruction, and as always, a lot of grace. Let us ask the Blessed Mother to make us to be grateful children of Mother Church, to have, as so few have today, almost like Noah and his family in the flood, so few have the grace of faith who will be saved from the flood. We don't know the rest of the story. We leave that to God's mercy. But today, we adore his majesty. God bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.